Welcome back to my channel. This is psychic medium Raymond Guzman, and today I'm going to be doing a psychic reading that has been highly requested and anticipated by a lot of people on my channel and through other social media outlets. In particular, I'm talking about Freddy Mercury, or I'm going to try to pronounce his real name is Farrokh Bulsara. I could have mispronunciated that, and I do apologize ahead of time. But he was the singer-songwriter through the famous band Queen. Everybody knows Queen and has heard of them before. They were a British band, and he was the lead singer and vocalist for that band. And he had a lot of success throughout his time as, you know, his stage name, Freddie Mercury. And I haven't seen the new movie that's out. I've had some friends that have told me about it, that they've seen it. They haven't told me exactly what it's about. I have never seen any kind of documentary on him other than that, you know, he was a famous singer, and I've heard some of his music, you know, the band's music out there. So I'm coming into this reading without even having seen the new movie that's out. I don't know if it's a biopic movie or what kind of movie, but I heard it's about him, about his life. So my reading today is not going to be based on that, but based on channeling information and giving you what I know and what I see from his soul. So the first thing that is coming through with him is that he felt very much judged throughout his life here on Earth. Being an individual that was very unique, he was very much misunderstood by a lot of people. I think a lot of people saw him as this persona that wanted to have the fame and wanted the money, and that he was, you know, a drug addict, and that wasn't who Freddie Mercury was. What I get from him, yes, he may have fallen into certain of the temptations of those things, you know, throughout his life here, but he was a very good good individual, a good soul, but very complicated. I feel like he was definitely someone who was like an indigo in many ways. He wasn't, you know, your typical human being. And with most singers, you know, that come here to Earth, or people that have a big platform that, you know, they're impacting the world through their music, or, you know, they have a specific mission here on Earth and purpose. And I feel like with him, he was definitely like someone that had, you know, extraterrestrial DNA. And I've said this before with some other artists as well that I do see, you know, he definitely was someone that knew that his time here on Earth was limited in many ways. He came here for a short period of time to bring about some change, and I'll get more into that in a minute. But the message that I'm getting from him is that he felt judged. But you have to understand, this is not 2018 that we're talking about. We're talking about the 70s and the 80s and even the late 60s. And this was a time period in which homosexuality and bisexuals and, you know, being, you know, gay in that time frame was not something that was accepted as it is today. And even today, there's still discrimination from people, you know, all around the world. It's not something that's fully accepted. Yes, society has opened up, just like, you know, racism has not gone away at all. It's still very prevalent in society. But I do feel like he did have a certain level of shame in his soul, is what he's telling me. He felt judged. At the same time, he felt sort of like a shame for being who he was, but he didn't understand why he had feelings for both sexes, you know, for men and women. But I do feel from a very young age that he did have that dichotomy, or that that duality to his soul, and very much misunderstood. I feel like he kept things like a secret from his family and from people, even from his friends. Only certain people knew about, you know, his relationship. But he was very unique. He had a lot of, you know, when he got into the music industry and started singing, he found an outlet for his creativity, and he felt like he could be really himself on stage, and that's when he felt most alive. But I feel like for the most part, he wasn't happy, you know. And this is something I did recently with like Janis Joplin when I was channeling her soul. The same thing for Freddie. I feel like he wasn't fully happy in his life. There wasn't fame didn't bring him happiness. The stage brought him happiness and the music, but fame didn't bring him happiness when he wasn't on stage. And being surrounded by so many people, they wanted to know about his personal life. They wanted to know about him. He didn't feel ultimately happy. And so he found that, you know, he couldn't no longer contain. He was, you know, together with Mary Austin for quite some time. He did have a lot of open relationships. And I feel like there's a lot of people that would be able to relate to that listening to this today that are in that same mindset. They see it almost like therapeutic or almost like it's a recreational type of thing, you know, when it comes to sex. And it's not like that, you know. Sex should be something that's considered sacred and pure. It is an exchange of energy. So in many ways, when he was having these open relationships with other people, and you know, if he was still with Mary and even before her, I do get that there would have been some type of he was very damaged. There was things that, you know, that he didn't really talk about, that he saw and things that he felt that he couldn't explain. There was some kind of level of abuse when he was a child as well. Again, I don't know if this was something that was portrayed in the movie, or because I haven't seen it, but I do get that there would have been some level of abuse that he would have experienced early in his youth. But getting into these relationships, he was seeking to heal some part of himself by having these open relationships. But never once contemplating. And there was a lot of, you know, drug use, there was alcohol, there was different things that he would have fallen into temptation for, again, all to suppress his true feelings of what he was feeling. I also feel like he had a lot of karmic issues when it comes to love, and this was a big theme for him. So this is another reason why he would have had a lot of open relationships, and he would have fallen into these, you know, situations that didn't lead him to any kind of happiness. He was chasing happiness in some kind of way. That's the best way I can explain it. It's kind of hard to say. He was chasing happiness, but it didn't, he never found it. He never really found the happiness that he was looking for. There was a lot of fighting in his life, a lot of battles. Record executives, I feel like they were, you know, a lot of people that were around him told him the things that they thought he wanted to hear. You know, they kind of contributed to his lifestyle. It was a very fast lifestyle, sleepless nights, always on the go, lack of energy, you know, sleeping till like late afternoon, maybe, you know, just and waking up and not even remembering. This is what I'm getting from his soul, not like waking up and not, you know, remembering things that happened before. And drugs will do that to you, and a fast lifestyle and being sleep deprived. And this all led to, you know, him having unprotected sex, and also, you know, sharing needles and things like that, you know, in general. Again, this may not be something that was portrayed in the movies, I don't know, but this is what I'm getting from his soul and what I'm getting overall. But he was a very hard worker. Once he started getting the money in, I feel like it wasn't enough, and they did him wrong with the money that he would have been getting in from, you know, from his sales, record sales and stuff. There was some shady stuff that was going on with his money, but he was all about working very hard to kind of build a future for himself. In some ways, he did, you know, have a vision of seeing or wanting to have a child with Mary when he was with her, but something held him back. I feel like he felt like he wouldn't be the right, he couldn't, you know, be the father that child deserved in many ways, because he wouldn't have been there dedicated. His career took over in many ways. But he's saying that he was all about the money, and he did have, you know, quite a fortune, you know, back then, considering, you know, the time period. And he kept building on this, on his music career. That was very everything for him. But there was a lot of loss around him that he would have experienced, a lot of friendships that would have ended, people that saw his attitude change, his personality, and didn't like that about him. I also feel like he had good friendships, but again, his choices and his inability to you know, commit or inability to find true love led him to pushing people away that cared about him the most. There were some good people. I get there would have been some male friendships that would have, you know, told him, hey, you know, you need to slow down, or hey, you need to stop this. But he was ultimately in his own mindset, and he wouldn't have changed it. He was very stubborn. There is an older gentleman that is also coming through in this reading. Very much feels like a father figure for Freddie. And he was very strict, I'm getting, within the family dynamic. And what he is saying is that he didn't approve of what Freddie was doing while he, you know, was here in the physical world doing these things. He didn't approve of this, and now that he's in spirit, he's saying that, you know, it was just something that Freddie couldn't see the damage that was being caused, but all he wanted him to do was to find his strength. But in many ways, Freddie was not the person that could find strength here on earth. It was something, you know, he never felt, like I said, connected. And that's the thing with most star seeds and most indigos and crystal children and rainbow children that are here on the physical world. A lot of people don't, a lot of these special souls don't feel very connected here. It's always feeling like judgment, like you're being judged or you're different from other people. People just don't understand your vibe or understand, you know, your reason for existence. But yeah, you know, when he got into the relationship with Mary, I do feel he truly did love her. They were there was a lot of ups and downs, arguments and whatnot, but ultimately she did love him, you know, with unconditional love and acceptance. But she didn't condone of, you know, his drug use and these open relationships that he kind of kept or tried to keep secret from her. She wasn't naive. She knew more or less that he was doing this, and I feel like there would have been discussions around this with him. And also when he got in the relationship with his hairdresser, Jim Hutton, there would have been some discussions with him as well. He was kind of conflicted. I feel like he was with Jim not so much that there was a love, but there was almost this void and this convenience, this utility that he was there with him. But yet his heart, when I get into Freddie's soul, is there was somebody else. There was another male as well, other than Jim at the time. And there was this, like, this battle, you know, in his mind, he couldn't really put his feelings together. But then the illness came, you know, he started getting weak, his immune system, he started losing weight, a lot of nausea. I get, like, he wouldn't have been able to eat good. Then he had respiratory issues. You know, his blood cell count was down. There would have been, like, he just would have been really, really out of it, not feeling good at all. Towards the last 2 years of his life, his health took a very big downturn, and I do feel like there was medicines, you know, he was given. He did try to take some drugs and stuff, you know, to suppress a lot of this and kind of numb some of the pain that he would have gone through. This was a very painful process because the disease of itself that he had, HIV/AIDS, I feel like he didn't really, like, he took it very hard when he found out. And I feel like, contrary to what is being portrayed and whatnot, it really, like, he was faced for the first time with his mortality, with the fact that he knew that he didn't have too much time. And I feel like his soul knew this before passing. He knew that he didn't have that much time, and he was making preparations, you know, before he would have passed. And he felt death coming. That was something that was, like, inevitable, that he could have pushed away. He did die, I believe, at age 47 or something like that, in the 40s. Very, very young age. You know, some would say that this is before his passing. But every soul that comes to Earth, we get to choose our blueprint and our exit point. And we know more or less, like, when we're going to exit before we're even born. That's part of our blueprint. But it's up to us to decide, you know, which exit point we choose. And with him, you know, this was the exit point that he chose, you know, that age. I do feel like he would have OD'd at some point in his life. This could have been in the 80s or very close to ODing. This is what I am getting from his soul. And he kind of, you know, snapped out of it. But, you know, when you couple that with the disease and, you know, his relationships. He was like running. He didn't love himself completely. And this is something that he, if he could go back, he would have really tried to, change it. He loved his persona. He loved the music. He tried to express himself through makeup, through the wardrobe, being flamboyant, trying to be authentically who he was. But essentially, what he makes me feel is that all of that was more of like a facade or like a show. Deep down, he was very fragile, and he suffered from depression. He would have suffered from, loneliness. There's a sense of loneliness that even because a lot of people that would be listening that are in relationships with people, for convenience or utility, there is an empty void, that can be there, and it doesn't matter, if they're there and you go places with them and do things with them, and they show you some kind of love back. There's different levels of love. I don't feel like he was fully fulfilled. I do feel like Mary was his twin flame, and Jim was, I want to say, almost like, no, let me say that again. I'm gonna re because I'm getting that wrong. They're saying, okay, Mary was his soulmate, and Jim was a twin flame. So, with the soulmates, we can have more than one soulmate here on Earth. These are souls that are very much like kindred souls. They're very much alike, and there's always going to be this level of love and understanding, undivided understanding, that unspoken understanding that even if you're not with them, that you know that they're okay, and there's a lot of unconditional love, and you want to just see them to be happy. With twin flames, it's a little different. They're two souls that are, one and the same. It's very similar, it can easily be interpreted as a soulmate, but twin flames are different. There's a lot of chasing and running. There's a lot of control factors here, and it's almost like there is this need to, there's a lot of codependency in twin flame relationships, and it's not always the case. Some twin flame relationships can work out, but ultimately, I feel like with Jim, it was what was convenient. But Jim also would have experienced some level of pain knowing that Freddie wasn't loyal to him and that there would have been other men that he would have been with prior to his passing. There was other people that he would have been with, and another male who he felt a lot of strong feelings for that would have been a soulmate. But it was all kept almost like a secret from some people, in the media and whatnot. But that is what I'm getting from his soul, that like I said, Mary was the soulmate. And Jim Hutton would have been one of, the twin flame. But again, it was not destined to work out. And I think when he passed, when Freddie passed and his will was left and, the house was left or, whatever was left to Mary kind of took Jim by surprise. And he found out like, he kind of felt a little bit like, well, I guess I wasn't that important in his life. And that kind of speaks to the, the fact of your soulmate. I feel like what Freddie felt with Mary kind of scared him. And a lot of times it pushes them away when it's a soulmate, even though there's this level of love and understanding, it can push people away for whatever reason. Because a lot of times there's soulmate relationships. This is a whole complicated thing with Freddie. His love life was very complicated. But when you have a soulmate, sometimes there is a twin flame that can make an appearance while you're with your soulmate. And it creates this big confusion with your heart, your heart space, which you don't know if you want to be with your twin flame or you want to be with your soulmate. The twin flame relationships are very platonic. They're very volatile. They're very intense. Sexually, there's a lot of chemistry. There's a lot of, this feeling of trying to find happiness, but ultimately there's a void there. And that's what I ultimately feel like. He could never give his heart and soul to Jim completely, and he never could give that heart, his heart and soul to Mary, even though she was a soulmate. So there was like this great divide within his soul, and then all of the other relationships that he would have had, which were numerous ones, were just, to feel kind of to get off, to get some kind of gratification. But again, nothing concrete, nothing solid. And if he could go back and change, you know, who he was, what I'm getting from his soul is that what he would have changed would have been all of these, this promiscuity, this, these relationships that he would have had. He would have changed all of that lifestyle completely. Still accepting, you know, who he was, which was, you know, who he was at the soul level, you know, his sexual preference and all that would have still remained the same, but he wouldn't have been in so many relationships. And I also feel in many ways he wouldn't have allowed the fame to consume him in many ways, because that is what happened with the music. Had he had the right people around him and had he had more structure, you know, could he still be alive or could he have, you know, lived longer? The answer would have been yes. But again, through his passing, I think it opened up the eyes of a lot of people around the world who are HIV positive or HIV, you know, tested for HIV or are living with this disease, to kind of like, it kind of scared a lot of people after his passing. And it opened the eyes to America, because a lot of people think that, you know, AIDS or HIV is just a disease that is associated with homosexuality, which is not the case. You know, you can get it through blood transfusions, you can get it through heterosexual relationships, you know. But that was a big, you know, big thing back in the 80s, where when it first was, you know, or 70s, whenever HIV was something that came out into the world, you know, it was something that was very much discussed and confused. There was a lot of confusion. And so a lot of people like stereotyped homosexuals, you know, as being people that had, you know, HIV. And that was like the biggest spread or epidemic of it. But through his passing, I think it opened up the eyes of a lot of people to realize that, you know, it's not always that, you know, there's other factors and things that can contribute to it. It also opened up a lot of people through his life, you know, and even now through this, this, you know, for the new generations through this recent movie that came out about him, you know, or documentary, whatever you want to call it. It did open up the eyes of a lot of people to let them know that, hey, you know, relationships and your sexual lifestyle, you know, and it needs to be more of a sacred or divine order there. Again, you know, there's no judgment if you are in open relationships or you're not in a relationship with anyone that's committed and you want to do whatever you want to do, that's fine. You know, there's no judgment in that. But to a certain point, you know, there's certain measures that you need to take to protect yourself. There's certain things that you need to do to really understand that, you know, it's not all about sex and it's not all about the physical interactions. Sure, that brings you gratification, that brings you pleasure. Maybe there's a utility for it, you know, for you in your life, or convenience. Maybe you're with people, you know, a certain person because of your, you know, your position in life, or because of the role that you play in, you know, in your career. But ultimately, that doesn't bring you happiness. It all relies, happiness starts within ourselves, and a lot of healing. And that's what Freddie was trying to do throughout his life. He was trying to heal a lot of parts of himself that were damaged, a lot of his viewpoints on certain things. You know, he felt judgment from people. If people would have been more accepting of him and would have shown him love rather than judgment, I feel like, you know, things would have been different. He could have been here a little bit longer, and maybe he wouldn't have, you know, fallen, you know, sick with the disease as soon as he did. But regardless of that, this is how he chose to exit this world. And that, through that exiting point, you know, like I said, it created a lot of awareness for people all around the world, and through his story. So I do get that he was, there was a lot of fear towards his last minutes, his passing. But, you know, some people, when they are faced with their own mortality and they've been very strong throughout life, they may fear death or may not be able to really accept it. I feel like for him, you know, he did come to a point of accepting it, that this was his fate. But there was some fears moments before he passed. And I do get, again, there was this older male that would have been on the other side. So I don't know if this would have been his father or his grandfather. I kind of feel like it's a father figure, but I don't know if the time that he passed, if his father had already passed. But that's what I'm getting. There would have been like a fatherly energy that would have crossed him over to the other side, as well as some angels. So there was definitely a lot of healing. I do feel like he did spend a lot of time trying to transition and understand his transition, because he still felt very tied here to the physical world, even though, because when you are like someone like Freddy, who is very flamboyant, very much into the career lifestyle, you know, his passion was music. He had a lot of friends, you know, he left a lot of people behind. There's this sense of, you know, adjusting. So even though he had his life review and whatnot, I feel like his soul was took a lot more time than most people, because he had so many karmic issues here on in the physical world, and also a lot of baggage from his, you know, this life that he had just left, that it took him some time to transition over. And you know, the spirits on the other side had to help him kind of go through this spiritual healing with his soul to be able to even, you know, come and visit, you know, his loved ones here on Earth, his friends, and, you know, people that he left behind. But he does thank everyone for his legacy, for honoring his legacy. He is, you know, I get like his soul is not in agreement with every part of the movie that was out, but he says good job on, you know, what they were able to portray of him. But again, I just feel like he wasn't very, you know, thrilled with whatever the movie. I'm pretty sure it's pretty good. I haven't, like I said, I haven't seen it, but you know, he says that there's a lot of things that were not right in the movie, and there was things that were omitted. So you know, again, this is coming from spirit, but overall, you know, if you have, I'm gonna see the movie eventually. It has piqued my interest, so I do want to see it. To know a little bit more about his lifestyle, you know, what I got versus from what, you know, the movie portrays. But again, with, you know, Hollywood and, you know, these movies, there's always a lot of things that are omitted or changed a little bit, again, for the, sometimes for, you know, to sell the movie, you know, so it can make money and whatnot. But that's what I'm getting from spirit. So I want to thank you all for tuning in. If you did like this reading, please give it a thumbs up. Also, be sure to follow me on Facebook and Instagram. And if you would like to set up a private reading, you can go to my website. That's www.raymondguzman.net/shop. Blessings and love and light. Have an amazing day.